So then what I want to do finally is I'm not going to do this last pathway. I'm going to save that one for the end. We're done with the negative one for now. Okay? Now I want to go to the neutral pathway and then finish up with this last little stick. Okay? So let's go to the neutral pathway now. I know that was a mouthful, but now we have to do the neutral pathway. What if we have something like instead of OH negative, how if we just have water? Okay? Water's neutral, right? So now my second question is actually this pathway is a lot easier. All I'm going to ask myself is, okay, what type of leaving group do I have? Because if this is a neutral, then that's going to prefer what kind of mechanisms? That's going to prefer that it's going to be mechanisms that aren't bimolecular, that don't have the nucleophile attacking at the beginning. So this is going to favor SN1 and E1 mechanisms, right? Because it's going to be waiting around for a carbocation to be generated. Remember that first step? So then I just have to ask myself two things. I just have to ask, or one thing actually, for the second question. I'm going to say, what type of leaving group do I have? Do I have a leaving group that can make a good carbocation in the first step? Or do I have a leaving group that wouldn't make a great carbocation in the first step? Okay? So it turns out that if your leaving group doesn't make a good carbocation in the first step, that would be what type of alkyl halide? Well, remember that primaries and methyls are really bad at making carbocations. So I'm going to say here, bad carbocation. Okay? The two mechanisms that are good at making carbocations, because there's a lot of R groups, so it's going to stabilize it. Remember that I said R groups stabilize carbocations? Would be secondary and tertiary. So these would be good carbocations. Okay? And the mechanism's really just going to determine on which side you land. If you're on the bad side, that means that you have water. Water or whatever, neutral nucleophile. Can't do shit, really. It's just stuck there. It's not very strong. And then it's waiting for the first step, the rate determining step, to happen to make the carbocation, right? But then methyls and primaries make terrible carbocations. So guess what happens? Nothing happens. So what happens is that the end result is just no reaction because you have a bad nucleophile and you have a bad leaving group. So it's just the combination is just bad. So overall, you get nothing happening. But what if you have a good leaving group? How about if you have one that's going to be able to actually make a good molecule that could make a carbocation, like secondary or tertiary? Then that's where you're going to favor SN1 and E1. Because now you have that good carbocation that you can make, the neutral nucleophile can attack it, and the reason you get SN1 and E1 is because guess what? They compete with each other. So whenever you get an SN1 mechanism, you're also going to get E1 competing at the same time because the environment that favors SN1 is also favored for E1. Are you guys getting that? So we can never really separate the two. Now there is one thing that we could do to make it favor one over the other, and that is heat. Okay? So I'm just going to put here heat can favor E1. Okay? So that's true. Like, for example, if I ran it with these conditions where I had a neutral nucleophile, a tertiary alkyl halide, and then if I jack up the heat to like 50 degrees Celsius, then that can favor E1 over SN1, but you're still going to get a mixture of products. It's just you're going to get a little bit more E1. Okay? Cool. So now I want to talk about this last direction, which was how about if I am, I'm sorry about that again, how if I'm in the tertiary position and I want to. And I don't have a good base. Basically, I have a base that isn't good at pulling off protons. What that means is that this nucleophile wants to do an SN2, okay? Because it's not good at pulling off protons. So let's say something like I negative, okay? I negative is a molecule that is not very basic at all. It's a pretty good nucleophile, but it's a terrible base. It was very bad at pulling off protons, okay? So it's not on my list, right? It's not on my list of five. It's not OH minus. So that means that it wants to do an SN2, but it can't because the backside is totally clogged up. So instead, it's going to have to wait around for a carbocation to be generated, just like a weak nucleophile would have had to do in SN1 and E1. So you wind up getting SN1 and E1 from this situation. Okay? So I'm explaining the logic so that you guys will understand where this flowchart is coming from. But guess what? The coolest thing about this flowchart is that you don't actually need to understand it. And I know that's kind of like blasphemy for me to say that you don't need to understand it. But in the end of the day, you guys just want to do really well on your test, right? That's why we have clutch. And I want to be clutch for you guys. I just want you guys to memorize this flowchart. If you can understand it, awesome, even better. But in the event that maybe your test is in 2 days or whatever, I don't need you to know every single detail about why this, why that. I just need you to memorize what are the good bases, what are the different pathways for primary, secondary, tertiary. If you know that, how do I tell if something's neutral or negative? If you know those things, guess what? You could go into your test not knowing much about why this flowchart exists and still get every single mechanism right, okay? And that's because you memorize the flowchart and you know how to use it. So what that means is that for the rest of all the practice problems you do for this course, the ones that I give you, the ones that you have to do online, the ones that you have to do in your book, whatever you do, make sure you have this flowchart next to you and you start using it to determine what mechanism you're using. Because guess what? On your test, your professor isn't going to be so nice and tell you, draw all the products for the E2 reaction. No, guess what? They're going to let you figure that out on your own because you're supposed to know what mechanism it is. How? Well, you're supposed to be a genius. But in the case that you aren't a genius, that you can just use this flowchart and it's going to work out pretty well for you. All right? So I hope that that made sense. I do expect you guys to all try to memorize this at some point. But the best way is just through practice. Use it like an open book test and do all your practice problems with this flowchart in front of you, and eventually you'll have it memorized. All right, guys, so that's the end of that topic. Let's go ahead and move on.